fascicle, left posterior fascicular block. Left posterior fascicle is another branch of the left bundle branch block. It supplies the electrical transmission of the impulse to the posterior and the lateral part of the left ventricle. But as compared to the left anterior fascicle, it's a smaller one, and there are very rare chances of development of the blockage in the left posterior fascicle because it's not that much present in the left ventricle. So a huge part of the left ventricle needs to be infarcted before it can cause the left posterior fascicular block. So let's see left posterior fascicular block. Left posterior fascicular block. In the past, it used to be known as left posterior hemi block. Left posterior hemi block, but now it is known as left posterior fascicular block. So there is a very specific ECG diagnostic criteria of the left posterior fascicle. If I quickly make this diagram, after the AV node there is bundle of His, and it gives right bundle branch, septal branch and left bundle branch. This left bundle branch divides into left posterior fascicle and left anterior fascicle. So this is left posterior fascicle. Left posterior fascicle, and when there is a block or obstruction at this level, of the conduction system, it will not let the impulse pass through the left posterior fascicle. Impulse will be passing very normally through the left anterior fascicle, right bundle branch and the septal branch. So what is the ECG diagnostic criteria for the left posterior fascicle? ECG criteria. ECG diagnostic criteria for the diagnosis of left posterior fascicular block. First of all, in the diagnostic criteria of the left posterior fascicular block, there should be a true right axis deviation. True right axis deviation. What we mean by right axis deviation? From the previous discussions, we know that when lead 1 is negative, when lead 1 is negative and lead AVF is positive, we call it right axis deviation. When lead 1 is a negative lead and a lead AVF is a positive lead, we call it right axis deviation. And when we say the true right axis deviation, it means if we draw 360 circle, this is 360 circle, we make its four compartments. This is 0, minus 90, minus 180, this is plus 90. The area between the plus 90 and plus 180 is known as right axis deviation. So the axis should fall somewhere between the plus 90 and plus 180. This is minus 180 and this is plus 180. A 360 degree circle has been divided into a positive half and a negative half. So the first condition of the ECG diagnostic criteria for the left posterior fascicular block is there should be true right axis deviation. Secondly, there should be RS pattern in lead 1 and ABL, there should be an RS pattern in lead 1 and ABL, means there should be a small R wave. This is P, this is a small R wave and a deep S wave in lead 1 and ABL. This is known as RS pattern. The second condition for the ECG to have to qualify for the diagnosis of left posterior fascicle is that there should be a small R wave, a small positive deflection, and a very deep downward deflection or negative deflection or S wave in lead 1 and AVL. Third condition, there should be a QS pattern. There should be a QR pattern, not S pattern, QR pattern in lead 2, 3 and AVF. There should be a small Q wave, which we call physiological Q wave, and a tall R wave in lead. This is small Q, this is tall R. Lead 1, lead 2, lead, not 1 bulb, but lead 2, lead 3, and lead AVF. So, up till now, we have identified three diagnostic ECG criteria for left posterior fascicle. Firstly, there should be a true right axis deviation between positive 90 and positive 180. Secondly, there should be a small R and a deep S wave lead pattern in 1 and AVL. And there should be a small Q wave and a large R wave pattern in lead 2, 3 and AVF. And the fourth is, there should be narrow QRS complex. There should be narrow QRS complex. In majority of the cases, the left posterior fascicular block causes narrow QRS complex. Now, lastly, one should know that there is another very important aspect, that there should not be any other cause of the right axis deviation. There should not be any other cause of the right axis deviation. For example, there should be no pulmonary embolism. There should be no right ventricular hypertrophy. There should be no tricyclic antidepressant drug overdose. These are the causes which can cause right axis deviation. When there is a cause like this, we cannot say that this is left posterior fascicular block. First, we need to exclude those causes. Tricyclic antidepressant overdose will be excluded on the history. In case of the right ventricular hypertrophy, there will be a right axis deviation and there will be a tall R wave in lead V1. And in case of the pulmonary embolism, there will be a very particular sign which we call McGinn sign, McGinn white sign. Okay, let me draw. This is very famously known as S1 Q3 T3. In order to rule out a rule in pulmonary embolism, there is a McGinn white sign. McGinn white sign, which is famously known as S1 Q3 T3. What does it mean? There should be S wave in lead 1. Say this is lead 1, so there should be an S wave. This is S wave. Then there will be Q wave in lead 3 and there will be a T wave inversion. This is lead 3. This is a Q wave and this is T wave inversion. So this is known as S1 Q3 T3. This is known as McGain-White sign, and this shows that there is a pulmonary embolism present. So in those cases where there is a pulmonary embolism, there is a right ventricular hypertrophy, there is a tricyclic antidepressant drug overdosage, then you cannot say there is left posterior fascicular block, because the right axis deviation in those cases is because of those problem. Otherwise, if there is a right axis deviation, there is a RS pattern in lead 1 AVL, and there is QR pattern in lead 2, 3 and AVF. There is narrow QRS complex, then you can call the patient is having left posterior fascicular block. So left posterior fascicular block is diagnosed on the ECG. Then there is another thing, as it was in the left anterior fascicular block, there is a bifascicular block. Bifascicular block. When we will call bifascicular block in the presence of left posterior fascicular block, when there is a right bundle branch block plus there is left posterior fascicular block, we will call it bifascicular block. When is the right bundle branch block? When there is a broad QRS complex and RSR pattern in lead V1. This is R, this is S, this is R primer. Rapid ear pattern, R, RSR pattern in lead V1 plus left posterior fascicle is when lead 1 is negative, lead AVF is positive, and in lead 1 and AVL there is RS pattern, and in lead 2, 3 AVF there is S, Q and R pattern. So this is Q, this is R, this is R, this is S. So just to just sum up this whole thing, when there is a right bundle branch block, which we can diagnose with the because of the presence of RSR pattern in lead V1 and broad QRS complex, plus presence of the left posterior fascicular block in the ECG, which is when there is a right axis deviation, one is downward and AVF is positive or upward, and then there is a RS pattern, a small R and a deep S wave in lead 1 and AVL, and there is QR pattern, a small physiological Q and a tall R wave in lead 2, 3 and AVF, and there is narrow QRS complex, and there is no other cause of the right axis deviation, then we call it left posterior fascicular block. So right bundle branch block plus left posterior fascicular block is actually the bifascicular block. This is not clinically as significant, but if you diagnose the left posterior fascicular block, you can actually be alert, or you can alert the patient that you can have a higher order block in the future. So this is all about the left posterior fascicular block.